Okay, thank you, Professor Lee, for the introduction and the invitation. Now I present this work, Decoding Quantum Surface Codes via Belief-Propagation. This is a joint work with my project leader, Professor Lai. Okay, my motivation, quantum states are sensitive and error prone. We know that quantum surface codes is a kind of stabilized codes, provide an implementable topological structure for error correction. And since the coherence decays quickly, we want to face decoding. From the literature, we know that for an n-qubit surface code, the often mentioned decoding algorithm has a complexity proportional to n squared or at least n log n. We intend to use an efficient algorithm called Belief-Propagation, which has a complexity almost linear in n times a very small parameter compared, much smaller compared to n. And the issue is that the practical complexity and the decoding performance of BP for decoding surface codes, or in general for stabilized codes, needs to be improved. Okay, I will talk about this. Okay, I try to give the list definition and the notations, but I need to go through it before I can describe the algorithm. Okay, let Gn be the n-fold poly group. Okay, everybody is familiar with global phase and the n coordinate, and each coordinate is a poly matrix, 2x2 poly matrix. And for our discussion, for quantum error correction, it suffices to discard the global phase and write the tensor product as the Cartesian product we usually write. So if we collect all positive phase elements in the n-fold poly group, this set forms the basis of unitary matrix on the n-qubit space. Okay, if we collect, we select n minus k independent and commuting generators from this set. Okay, independent means one element, SM, cannot be generated by other generators. Okay, commuting is this. Okay, you can swap. Then, the generating set forms a stabilized group. Okay, an element is called a stabilizer, and the minus I will not in the stabilized group KLS. And it's well known that the fixed subspace of S defined by this way, all unit vector in the n-qubit space fixed by all element in the stabilized group. Is an NK stabilized code, which is a 2 to the K dimensional subspace in C2 to the N. So you can encode K qubit information into this space. For decoding, we need to do measurement. So let's suppose the error, we denote the error, an unknown error, a poly error, like this way. N coordinate. Okay, the measurement that we denote last page, if we write every measurement as a raw vector, then we have M times N check matrix over IXYZ. And every row, we can write it this way. It's, we denote it by SM, row vector over IXYZ. It corresponds to a measurement like this way. And for any two operators, poly operators, we use this notation like inner product. It's actually a GF2 bilinear form, okay? And FF prime commune, we say the inner product is zero. And if they anti commune, we say the inner product is one. So this zero corresponds to this measurement plus one is measured. And this anti commune result corresponding to this measurement minus is measured. Then we can define a binary error syndrome. That is, for an unknown error, if we do in the measurement defined by SM, then we will get a binary syndrome vector, and each the M, there will be a capital M bit, and the Zn will be the error, the unknown error, in the product with the measurement stabilizer SM. And that can be computed simply by this way, coordinate-wise, and plus summation of length and modulo 2. Okay, once we have all the previous information, we can do the decoding. Before define the decoding problem, we define an initial distribution for the error in coordinate n according to some error model. For example, for depolarizing channel model with error rate epsilon, the initial distribution for some error coordinate is like this. Okay, a decoding should have this output that's given a check matrix, M times N check matrix, a binary syndrome, M bits, and optionally, this distribution for N from one to capital N coordinates. The decoding given this information should output an error estimate, such that the error estimate should be in the actual error times the stabilized group, this coset, with a probability as high as possible. Okay, the probability will according to the channel model that we discussed. And then the Yueh dagger will be the error correction to be applied to the system. And for simplicity, if we assume S and the distribution of our channel characteristic is fixed, we can simply write this decoding by this way. Okay, to have some benchmark, we define some correction radius metric. That weight, E be the weight of an poly, an element in N-fold poly group, be the number of non-identity entries. And then we know that the minimal distance of the stabilized code CS can be defined as the minimal weight of all vectors that commune with stabilizers, but the vectors should not be in the stabilized group. Having this minimal distance, we can have the first basic correction radius, the normalized correctable radius of the bounded distance decoded. It has a correction radius TD equals to D minus 1 divided by 2 and get flow. And we normalize it by N as a normalized radius. Actually, as the decoding, we decode an estimate for every syndrome. So actually, we should have a normalized correctable radius of a syndrome-based decoding divided by this way. We correcting all E head and the estimate radius that in what radius TS we can cover loss error with probability one, close to one. for most channels, minimize the weight of E can maximize the probability of an error. So usually, syndrome-based decoding is assigned by this way. You find the error match the syndrome, but with the minimal weight. Then you will have the radius TS greater than TD, but the TS is hard to compute. For quantum code, it's a main difference with classical decoding is that you need to consider the degeneracy. So let's define the correct radius by this way. If we have a decoding, okay, syndrome-based decoding, then according to the decoding result, we collect all decoding result and run over all syndrome and enlarge the correction set by degeneracy. That is, if we collect all E hat, then we claim that E hat times KLS in this state can be all correctable, okay? This T is again hard to compute. How large is the radius, but it will be larger than TS. An important property in quantum and some quantum code is that this correction radius, when we normalize by N, could be positive, even if the distance radius, normalized radius is vanished.
Okay. Sorry, in the previous slide, the PN, I have some, right, what is this PN?
PN is the probability of the initial distribution of EN. That's our initial belief of the channel. For example, if you have a system and through measurement, you find that you have a probability 1%, it will be error. Then you, it's a poly error, then you have this initial vector that's assigned before decoding.
Oh, so it is the error probability of the error operator acting on the...
It's given from right. The channel model and from mm-hmm. the pre-measurement.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Well, let's see the example. Okay, the surface code due to KITAF. It's a family of this NKD stabilizer code. N is L squared, K is one, and D is L. For all odd L, integer L greater than or equal to three. One qubit information is encoded and protected by an L times L lattice, like this way. For example, if L is three, we have three times three lattice, and they are nine qubit, physical qubit. It will encode one information qubit in this lattice. And here is the basis state. We encode zero as zero L, the logic state. It's a super precision state, like this. Actually, it's this 4x stabilizers, and the product state and the superposition. And this one logic state is like this. So they are superposition state in a 9-qubit space. And when doing measurement, we have eight stabilizers. The first one is x1, x2. The second one is z1, z2, z4, z5, etc. And each measurement has a weight at most 4. For measurement, it's simple. If we have a stabilizer, look like this, Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4, then measurement is implemented in this way. That means actually here, you may have some physical and theta qubit, and you pull near local circuit here, then you can do the measurement. So X measurement similarly. And for the smallest 913 code, every weight one distance can, weight one error can be correct. They will have different syndromes. For example, if error is Z1, it will flip the logic state like this way. The sign here are flipped. And they will have a syndrome. The first syndrome bit is one and the other syndrome bit is zero. And if the arrow is X1, it will have this qubit flip and the other qubit untouched. And the syndrome will be 0, 1. And the other syndrome bit zero, okay? How to see this, let's check if Z1 is anti-commune with these stabilizers. So only these stabilizers will flip syndrome one. So we get this syndrome, okay? So after having this syndrome vector, we can do the decoding. Decoding for this code is very simple. If we see this syndrome, we just estimate E is Z1. E has Z1, this syndrome, E has X1, et cetera. And for a general case, for surface code, we encode a qubit in this logic state. If we suffered any poly error, then the stabilized measurement will guarantee the post measurement will not affect this measurement measured received cube state. Post measurement state will not change. And after we estimate correct error estimate, we applied this to this post measurement state, we will have our state corrected back to this state we deserved. Okay, an important property is that since there are many low-way stabilizers, the normalized correction radius grows as n increases. And for an optimal decoding, about 19% of the qubit can be corrected if n is large enough for a large surface code. And we will call a metric of a practical decoder threshold the attributable correction, normalized correction radius of the decoding scheme. Okay, let's see some decoders. Okay, two famous decoders are the minimum weight matching and the renormalization group. The minimum weight matching has a threshold about 15.5%. And it has a complexity that after simplification about n squared. The renormalization group do a decoding like decoding classical concatenation codes. So the complexity is n log n. And after some improve handling the RG group, the small RG group boundary, that means we partition a big lattice into small group lattice. And if we, without careful handling the boundary condition, we only have small threshold, but it improved by handling the RG boundary. And it can be further improved if we have every small group doing BP. So in the literature, it's up to 16.4% in this complexity n log n. Okay, BP, as we mentioned, has a complexity almost linear in n. So we want to solve the issue. First is the complexity, because it's about 6 times more complex than the classical BP decoding case. And the performance issue that is due to the show cycles in the check matrix tenograph. I will show it later. And our approach is we refine the classical BP as a refined BP, which will have scalar message. So it will have a lower complexity. Then we improve this refined BP to a BP with additional memory effect. We call MBP. And by adjusting the parameter we call the parameter alpha I, it will have improved the performance. Okay, the BP is a message passing algorithm running on a tenor graph. For example, if the check matrix, we use this simple example, is enough to for our discussion. It's X, Y, I, and the Z, Z, Y. So these two row are commute. Okay, one, one, so they commute. And if we draw a tenor graph, it will look this way. Because we have three qubit, we have three coordinate of error need to be estimated. And the first check in inferred, and this Sinjong check as one, check by this way. And the second check, introduce a check, check these three qubit by this way. So BP is doing like this. We start from an initial distribution for each coordinate. Okay, it might be fixed like this if we in a deployer in channel. And then given the structure of S and the some major syndrome, we will pass the message along the edge to right-hand side and doing some calculation and pass back and doing some calculation in each node. We have an updated brief for each error node. And from this update brief, we can estimate the error from the largest, it is probability I or X or YZ, which probability is largest. The message pacing is if we draw it like a circuit, it's just like the classical case, the binary BP. If we have undiched, then we pass it to check nodes and doing necessary calculation and pass back. And the edge is actually depends on the, in classical, it depends on a binary matrix. And actually after calculation for each digit, the calculation is like a tree. You use other nodes brief and through the check matrix structure, you use a tree computation to update for this brief in this coordinate N. And through some BP rule, BP will close to maximum likelihood decoding if the check matrix is sparse and without short cycles. And for quantum case, they are similar. If we use our simple example, use tenor graph, then it's just message passing to right-hand side, doing necessary calculation here, just like the middle stage and pass back, okay, doing necessary calculation. The difference is in quantum case, we need to handle every message a vector of length four. And the tenor graph of S will introduce short cycles like this. This is a short cycle. This is a cycle of length four. This will affect the PP performance a lot. Okay, so, we need to, before we improve it, we need to write down the general equation like this way. So we have this bin node N to check node M message is a length four vector. And so this from patch from left hand side to right hand side is a Q message from N to M. So we have, for this example, five message. And after necessary calculation, we'll pass back, this is N to N message. Again, length four vector. And then we can do the combination in variable node size. The most compressed part is the check node computation. It's many summation and products and the many combination of poly operators probability. Okay, we first simplify the algorithm. We observe the Sinjong check equation. If we write it like this way, then we have an important observation that the message from a check node of a variable node one will tell us how likely the error node one, E1, error E1 commune with or anti-commune with the edge SM1. Okay, it's a little abstract. So let's see the example. That means after we're doing this passing, this message passing to here or passing to here, actually tell this node how likely your distribution is commune or anti-commune with this edge type or this edge type. So it's just this simple. By this simple relation, we can rewrite the probability in a different way. So the vector becomes a scalar. And the checkernaut computation, we can use the classical one. And the aggregate will still equivalent to the quantum one that we want. So we can improve the efficiency 16-fold times. And more importantly, using scalar messages, we can apply an important classical technique called the message normalization. I will define it later. After applying the message normalization, the wrong belief caused by short cycles will be suppressed. Okay, we do a derivation through gradient descent plus BP rule to make the BP rule has some memory effect. So let's see here. Our checkernaut computation now is simplified from this one to this one. And we have a classical message normalization and the new message memory effect computation here. Okay, this the effect of the memory effect, I better explain it by figures. Okay, this is when we do in classical decoding, we often draw Hamming balls. This is the original. So this is the quantum BP starting point. In classical code, we often have had large weight code words. So if we have an error, it will between zero code word and the some large weight code word. And actually we are doing a gradient descent from this point to slowly get to this point and we're done. So BP will help us to complete this gradient descent. But quantum case is like this. Now we have even the zero cohort, the zero quantum logic state contains many zero cohort, classical cohort. And the quantum logic state is like this, black points. So if you want to decode an error, if there are many errors you can target, but a side effect is that you have many classical small weight cohort here. So you like to squeeze this geometry. So it's very hard to do gradient descent. So you need to enlarge your step size, but on the other way, you don't want the search to be random. So this is the advantage we find that the memory effect can overcome. Okay, let's see the simulation. Okay, we first see a small 5-qubit code. This is famous code 513. And using our algorithm, we find that like alpha about 1.5, it can do a very good decoding. And if we fix initial condition according to this value, then we redo the decoding again. We find that the decoding can along the Mesmer-like hood decoding, the RW bound. Okay, this call do not have strong degeneracy. So we need a smaller step size. This is by alpha I greater than one. And if we check the some error pattern, this error pattern is that the original BP cannot decode. So the BP keep fluctuation. But if we apply alpha I 1.5, we find finally the BP converge. It slowly suppressed the wrong belief and converged to I, okay? Okay, I skip this. And for surface codes, we just see a simple pattern. We can understand how the decoding runs. If we have a big lattice like this, and we use these three colors to denote XYZ arrow. So if we have an arrow pattern like this, then we have this border face, the syndrome flip. And a classical BP, conventional BP4 cannot do a correct decoding. It will converge to a wrong arrow and trap there. But if we apply alpha I, a small alpha, smaller alpha I, smaller than one, which means we use a large step size, and together with memory effect, we can converge to a correct degenerate arrow. So you can see how this degenerate arrow quite different with this arrow. That means that probably the true arrow is here, but we can jump to any equivalent arrow here. So we see the overall performance. If we decode from small to large surface, before improvement, the decoding performance diverge. But after improvement, by proper alpha I, the decoding converge to about 1 to 2 times of BDD. This is match our classical expectation. This page just explained that we use some metric to clarify that the improvement is by degeneracy. And the average iteration after improvement is very small. So the improvement is achieved by beta convergence. Okay, we can do further improvement because BP only do about 2 times of BDD. We maybe want to have a good ratio. We need this large BDD, very, very large BDD correction sphere. So we imply the technique sometimes called Monte Carlo sampling or parallel tempering. So we use BP4 with different alpha I from large to small. And if we run in sequence order, we will find that the first one we meet is the solution that we want. And the large alpha I will not have a converged result. So we just find the first converged result. And then we redo the decoding again. We find that originally the D equals to 17, saturate here, it is improved to here. And for the threshold that we mentioned, okay, we plot the we need to enlarge this intersection point. It's about up to 16%. Okay, torical. Torical is like surface code, but you fold their boundaries. So it will, without a boundary condition, then it will have better threshold, almost more than 17% in our decoder. So this is very close to the 19. Okay, benchmark is 19, but that those decoding, if you want to efficient benchmark, is almost mostly 16 or something. So we have a very good result. Okay, I draw the conclusion. I think it's just like what I say. So I just say we have some ongoing work. We want to do some partial pairs, and we want to cover for tolerant, and we want to use an efficient way to estimate the best alpha. And we want to give a rigorous proof for the convergence. Thank you.
Okay. And if all my understanding is not wrong, why do this error correction, like you use apply the BP missile to do some correction, and this is because you cannot find the real P in the real case, right? It's my first question.
You mean find
this
rho of P?
Or P.
No,
just,
we want to find is E.
Okay, yeah. Okay. So the you want to use the circle second grade descent and something like that, and want to find the E in the real case, right?
Yes, from an measurement syndrome.
Okay.
We need to infer the which E is happen.
And can you remind me about the alpha in the BP process and expand the memory effect again?
Okay. Classical BP is usually in a log domain. In log domain, it's just message divided by some alpha. So it's called normalization. In linear domain, we write it in this way. So it's need to have the power is 1/(alpha. But we have an algorithm in log domain, but I still have not time to complete sketch it. But even in linear domain, you can use some numerical method by one multiplication and the two addition to do this computation. So this is the check to variable message normalized by some alpha. This is where classical algorithm have. What classical algorithm doesn't have is this. So we when variable not return the message, usually you won't involve this term because the BP rule usually has this exclusive summation rule. But we will have this, we will break this rule. So it will bring additional memory effect in this step.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, for this case, without fault-tolerant, I just assume the circuit, yeah, is fine. So we need about proportional to L times L squared, but this everyone is a physical qubit. Okay, so it's about, overall it's about two times L times L, right? The yellow dot is qubit. Yellow dot, and times two, yeah. And this call performance, if the decoding, maybe like three here, something here. Challenge is still for tolerance, yeah.
Okay, so we'll move to the last talk in this morning session.